Buen día a las compañeras y compañeros de los medios de comunicación. Gracias por acompañarnos a la conferencia de prensa a distancia en la que se presentará la primera reproducción en el mundo de una galaxia similar a la Vía Láctea hecha en supercomputadora. Nos acompañan el doctor Héctor Manuel Velázquez, el doctor Octavio Valenzuela Tijerino, ambos del Instituto de Astronomía de la UNAM, el maestro Leobardo Itegua Rico, coordinador de supercómputo de la Dirección General de Cómputo Académico y de Tecnologías de la Información y Comunicación de la UNAM, el doctor Santi Roca Fábrega, investigador de la Universidad Complutense de Madrid. La conferencia se desarrollará de la siguiente manera: presentación del programa, resultados de Ágora, espacio para preguntas de la comunidad científica, resumen en español y sesión de preguntas para medios de comunicación. Recibimos las preguntas de los medios de comunicación vía WhatsApp al teléfono que aparece en pantalla. En este momento, favor de incluir nombre, medio, además de a quién va dirigida su pregunta. Les sugerimos nos envíen un mensaje para registrarlos y enviarles material informativo de esta conferencia de prensa. Le pido atentamente haga uso de la palabra al doctor Octavio Valenzuela Tijerino.
Welcome everyone to this special edition of the UNAM Institute of Astronomy Colloquium. Today, it is a pleasure to have Santi Roca Fábrega from the Universidad Complutense in Madrid. Santi is a well-known person by our community since he performed a large fraction of his PhD thesis in our institute. Currently, Santi is a member of the Ágora Collaboration. Ágora stands for a high-resolution galaxy simulation comparison initiative. He will present the latest results and data from the Ágora collaboration during 30 minutes, a 30-minute talk, and at the end, he will have a session of questions from the audience. If you have a question, please raise your hand in Zoom. Santi, please, you can start with your presentation.
Okay, thank you. Hello, Octavio, for this nice introduction. So yes, I will present today the results of the Ágora, the latest results of the Ágora collaboration. Let me share the screen now. Okay, perfect. So just to start, first of all, I want to mention that this is the work that I am presenting today is basically the result of a collaborative effort. I am just presenting the results that we obtained together after many hours of collaboration with a lot of people, most of them are listed below as the co-leaders of this project. And to start this presentation, I will make first a short summary of what the Ágora project is, just for the people that doesn't know about it. So the Ágora project is basically this collaborative effort in where what we tried is to set an infrastructure and a collaboration in where many people from around the world working with different numerical codes for galaxy formation work together to know which of the results they are obtaining are more code dependent than others. For example, you have in this slide, the spirit of the collaboration summarized it in one slide. This slide was made by the project coordinator, that is Jihoon Kim. And in here, you can find, first of all, the infrastructure we are using in the Ágora collaboration. Also, the main goal, the team that basically is as big as 160 or more people from around the world, from more than six institutions. And nine different code groups are participating on this collaboration. These nine codes are the ones of most used in the community for the production of this kind of formation and evolution simulations. You can find also in this slide at the bottom left, the contact if you will to participate on this project. You just need to send an email to the Santa Cruz Galaxy at gmail.com. In this project also, we already published three papers and I will go very fast through each one of these papers we already published. Basically the collaboration started in 2012 and during the kickoff meeting and the first meetings, we set what is the main goals of the project. And basically the main goals are, first of all, to set this infrastructure for the comparison of high resolution galaxy formation simulations using different numerical platforms. And this, as I told you, is very important because it's to make the same simulations from the same initial conditions using different codes and to analyze the differences and the similarities that arise from this comparison. Also, one of the big goals of the collaboration was to generate common isolated and cosmological initial conditions. This is something that was done from the very beginning for the first comparisons we did. Also, what we will is to analyze these results from the simulations in a fair way using similar or the same analysis tools, and also to do this analysis not for a single epoch but for a wide range of epochs, for the whole evolution of for example a galactic halo from the very high redshift to the very low redshift, and also in multiple dimensions, not focusing in the single parameters but exploring different sets of parameters, for example gas temperature density, but also dark matter distribution, stellar distribution, star formation. Also important in this project is that we don't want to focus in a single one-time code comparison. What we want is to provide the community of the tools to make this multi-platform a comparison for all the new codes that are appearing, that are being generated by the community. Also to make several science cases, we call them science cases, that is comparison with, for example, observations of what we observe in our models. And the important goal here of or why we are doing this is basically because if we know which parameters are more robust within the different codes, so if you use different codes and you obtain the same result, this means that this is the results are robust. And also if we find that some parameters are very, very highly sensitive to the numerical code you use, with this, we can kind of raise the predictive power of the numerical models, because we will know which parameters really converge when using different numerical codes. So the predictions will be robust, and which ones you need to be careful when comparing these results with observations. And something that I think the most important part of this collaboration is basically that we want to not only maintain, but generate an ambient of collaboration, of sharing results, of discussing the results from different codes. And this is very important because all the people that works with simulations knows that usually each code group works independently and sometimes kind of fighting with the other code groups. And the idea of the Agora is to put all these people together, to work together, to generate similar models, and to discuss which implementations are the best ones inside the different numerical codes. So inside this Agora project, after 2 years it started, in 2012. In 2014, 2 years after starting, we published the first paper. In this first paper, we call it the flagship paper. We presented the project goals and perspectives for the Agora project. And also we did a proof of concept test that is basically to run a collapse of dark matter structures using 9 different versions of the participating codes and focusing in one halo, low mass, 1.7 10 to the 11 solar masses at the tip of zero. For this first work, we used 3 AMR codes. You have here at the bottom left, ART2, ENZO, at the very bottom right, RAMSIS. These are 3 AMR codes. And the other ones, you can see 4 different versions of Gadget, and also Gasoline and PKD graph. And the main results of this paper were that after working with the simulation, with the simulations of collapsing dark matter structures, after correcting some minor errors inside each one of the codes, we finally got a very good convergence on the density profile of the dark matter halo. This is something you can see in the panel at the right, and you can see that the profile adjust very well to the same curve from all the 9 different participant codes. And in the middle, you can see the opposite part, that is something that is not converging. That is, for example, something we noticed is that in the AMR codes, we generate a little bit less low massive dark matter halos than for the SPH codes. This is something very well known and something that we also observe in the last project that is the one I am going to present today. In the second paper, the paper we call the isolated disk paper, that was again 2 years after the first paper, we generated a set of 9 simulations, again using 9 codes. These 9 codes are different from the 9 that appeared in the first paper. And here what we did was to set the initial conditions for an isolated galactic disk with a gaseous halo. and we let this evolve. And then we compared how these galactic disks that are Milky Way-like disks, differ from one code to the other. What is important from this set, most of the parameters in the simulation, both for the star formation, for the supernova feedback, so we try to get conversion at the end. You can see that more or less we got convergence, although, again, some differences can be observed. For example, at the bottom panels, you see the distribution of stars, and you can see that there are different clamps in different positions for each one of the codes. The data from this second paper is already available. We published it in 2020. You can see here at the bottom right the link to the archive in where we announced the data release, and many other code groups from 2020 to now using this data to make new follow-up papers. And something that is important also that we developed during the publication of these two first papers is the infrastructure, the Agora infrastructure. This is very important because it's what allows us to continue with our fair comparisons among the different numerical codes. This has three different blocks, this infrastructure. The first one that is the initial conditions generator that was presented by Oliver Hahn in 2011. And this is the music code. We are commonly using it to generate the initial conditions inside the collaboration. The second big part of this infrastructure is the YT analysis tools. These were presented by Matthew Turk in 2011. And this allows us to read the outputs from all the numerical codes that are participating in Agora and to analyze them in the same way using the same tool so we can make a fair comparisons and to make equivalent diagnostics from each one of the numerical codes. So this is a very important part also of the Agora project. And related with this, also now there is a new piece of software for the analysis that is called Trident that allows us to generate sidelines observations, for example, from background quasars. And the last block of this infrastructure is the Grackel radiative transfer code that allows us to compute in the same way inside each one of the numerical codes the cooling and heating of the gas, both in the intergalactic medium and in the galactic medium, and also to include, for example, sources of ionizing radiation, or, for example, also the self-shielding of the very dense regions. This can be now directly implemented inside each one of the numerical codes, allowing us to reduce, again, the number of three parameters we are using inside each one of the codes. Said that, with this introduction, now I go to the latest results in the Agora project. That is what we called the Cosmo Run. This was published 2 weeks ago. It was accepted in the APJ. And also you have the link to the archive here at the bottom. And for this project, for the Cosmo Run project, that is this third project inside the Agora project, we devoted more than 4 years of collaborative work. You can see that to generate a cosmological simulation and to reduce the possible variables that are inside a so complex a model like a cosmological simulation that includes also the hydrodynamic, we needed not the usual 2 years that we needed for the first paper and for the second paper, but it was four and a half years to get this work done. So it was a huge amount of work. Also, we did more than 30 online telecons, very productive, with a very big and good discussions among the different participants, so very, very good meetings. Also, we did 3 summer workshops in where we discussed a lot the progress of the project. Also, for example, we discussed to split the current the Cosmo Run in two. The original goal was to analyze directly the CGM at the low redshift, but finally we decided to present first this paper that is a more technical paper, and in the future, in the very close future, the analysis of the CGM inside the models we present here today. And also we needed to use more than 100 million CPU hours for all the calibration steps that I will present and also to get the final model. And this was done by 7 code groups. And this is probably the most important part here, that is the first time in the community we have 7 code groups using the same initial conditions to simulate the formation of a Milky Way mass halo down for the moment at redshift of 4 from the common initial conditions. So after summarizing what the Agora project CosmoRAN is, let me go to the first part of the results we are presenting. We have two big results. The first one is the calibration. The calibration at the end was some kind of subproduct of this process of generating the final model. And basically, the idea was to set a series of four steps that allows us to reduce the tunable parameters inside simulations. It is true that is not the only possible calibration process, cannot be the optimal one, but is the one that we ended up with after many, many telecons, many, many discussions. And the important part of the calibration is not the steps, but the comparisons we need to do in each one of them and the scientific discussion and the insight we gain each time we analyze the differences we observe in each one of the calibration steps. So I will go now very fast to each one of the calibration steps we ended up with. The first one is the calibration step one, the one we call the pure collapse. In this case, in all codes, we start in initial the same initial conditions with gas and dark matter, but we do not allow to the gas to cool or to heat by radiative cooling or heating. We do not include the ultraviolet background. We do not include self-shielding. And we also do not include the pressure floor, the star formation, or the supernovae feedback. It's basically a pure collapse in a cosmological context. So in this case, what we wanted is to test that the basic physics are implemented well in all the codes, and that we get convergence when only the basic physics are applied. Also, this allows us to study how the resolution and the refinement strategy inside, for example, the AMR codes can have or not an impact on, for example, the heating in the shocks when the structures collapse. And for here in this panel, you can see at the bottom a multi-panel in where in each column you have a different code. In the first row, you see the density of gas. In the bottom row, the temperature of gas. And you see that there is a very good convergence in density at the small differences on the temperature. And I will talk about these small differences in the calibration three step and what we are doing to try to solve this problem of, not a problem, to try to understand these kind of differences we observe in the temperature space. In the second calibration step, now we activate the radiative cooling heating. We activate the ultraviolet background. We also activate the self-shielding of the very dense regions. And all this implemented using the Grackle software, the version 3.1.1. So this calibration step two, the main goal of the step is to really test, to check that the Grackle software is well implemented in each one of the codes. And also, at the same time, to make a sanity check on how Grackle is behaving. So if Grackle has the correct routines and is well coded also this software. What we could see, for example, during the process of this calibration step two, is that at very high densities, due to the interpolation that you need to do, because you don't have, for example, the very detailed cooling and heating of gas for a specific density, but you have the cooling and heating rates for a binet distribution of densities and temperature. This is something you can see at the bottom left. What happens is that due to this discretization, when you look at the temperature density parameter space, that is the plots you have at the right, at the very high densities that you observe in some of the codes, for example, in Gadget 3 or Gear, but this also has been observed in RAMSES and other codes, you see this kind of cooling tails that are an artifact due to the discretization. This is not a problem in a cosmological simulation like the one we are using here, because as soon as you turn on the star formation, the gas that is above this dashed line, this vertical dashed line, is used for star formation, so you never reaches this very high density region. So these cooling tails are not really a big problem for us here. Although we argue that we need to improve the this interpolation to go to higher degrees of interpolation to solve this problem, and also probably to use better sample tables for the cooling and heating rates. Once completed the calibration step two, we can go to the calibration step three. And in this calibration step, what we do is, apart of having again the radiative cooling and heating with Grackle that we already tested that is working. We now activate the pressure floor that avoids the fragmentation, the spurious fragmentation of gas, and also the star formation. And we impose that the threshold for the star formation in all the codes is 1 atom per centimeter to 3. Apart from that, we let some flexibility to each one of the code groups to change a little bit, for example, the efficiency, the stochasticity in the case they implement the star formation in a stochastic way, to finally get a convergence on the stellar mass at redshift of 7. This is the only thing we look for in this calibration step 3, and you can see the result at the bottom left in this panel, in where you can see the stellar mass growth for each one of the codes. Each one of the curves is one code, and you can see the stellar mass growth from the redshift of 13 or 12 down to redshift of 7. And you can see that within 0.3 dex, all the codes converge on the stellar mass. This is what we look at for, this convergence of a stellar mass at redshift of 7. And why this is so important? Well, because if we want to make a fair comparison, we need that all the codes generate similar stellar mass at high redshift. So they have a similar mass assemblage history at high redshift, because this will, if you have a much larger mass at high redshift, you will produce much stronger feedback and the galaxy will be completely different. So the halo will be completely different. So we needed to check that for only at least the stellar mass at high redshift is the same for all the codes. In this multi-panel you have at the bottom right, you can see again for each one of the codes in each column, at the top, the densities, in the middle panels, the temperatures, in the bottom panels, the stellar surface density. You can see the stellar surface density more or less converge in all codes. You have more or less the same structures in similar positions. So the positions of the stellar structures and also the total stellar mass within the BDL radius is similar. This is kind of convergence. But again, we can see some divergence, not in density, that is the top panel, but yes, in temperature, that is the middle panel. And although this can look dramatic, when we activate the supernovae feedback, that is the larger amount of energy that is released in this region, this heating you can see here is only the result of the shock heating, for example. This one that you observe here, these differences you observe here, will be completely minor when confronted with the supernovae feedback, the differences in the supernovae feedback. Nonetheless, in a follow-up project, we are planning to study the origin of these very small differences, but at least, but at the end, differences, and we are preparing a technical paper in where we will study this this topic. But for the current project, this was not a big problem. And finally, we have the calibration step 4. Once completed the other 3 calibration steps, we now activate the supernovae feedback. And something very important here is that we ask all the code groups to use the supernovae feedback as similar as possible to the one they use in their daily science outside the ARA project. Because what we want is to see the results of using more or less the same strategy that the code group is using in their daily science here in Agora and compare the results when using the same initial conditions. So we asked all the codes to use the supernovae feedback as close as the one they usually use in their daily science. This is what we call the favorite supernovae feedback. And the only thing we ask all the code groups again is to reach a stellar mass at redshift of 4 that is compatible with the one predicted by semi-empirical models of abundant matching at redshift of 4. That is in between for this kind of halo of Milky Way mass halo at redshift of 4 is more or less in between 10 to the 9 and 5 times 10 to the 9. And you can see here at the bottom left in this panel, again, the different curves are the different codes. This is the mass growth with redshift. And you can see that at the end, at redshift of 4, all the codes converge within this 0.5 dex. The gray shadowed region you see at redshift of 4 is the range accepted as a prediction from the abundant matching, the semi-empirical models. And okay, after completing the calibration steps, we get the final model that now can be used to do a more science-oriented project. And at this point is in where we invite new codes to participate to the Agora project. Now is the moment. We have this very clear calibration strategy with these 4 steps. We ask new code groups to follow these four calibration steps and to join the future that will be many science-oriented projects. For that, we will provide technical help to complete the calibration steps. We will also give them easy access to all the data we have from the other code groups, so they can make the comparison and they can be sure that they are completing the calibration process. And also we will give them access to the overall workspace, and also we will invite them to the next science-oriented meetings, online meetings, that usually you need an invitation to access to them. So the idea now is to make generate this reference library of models that will be the result of following this calibration step that can increase the predictive power of the numerical simulations. If we have more codes participating, we will have an enriched comparison in the future, and we'll have a better view of how the different results depend or not on the numerical codes we are using. And now, going to the last part of the talk, is the second big part of results we are presenting, and is basically that we generate for the first time in the community a simulation and restrict of four, a cosmological simulation, including the hydrodynamics, high resolution of a Milky Way mass halo at this redshift of four. This is the first time that is done in the community for seven different numerical codes that are widely used in the community of galaxy formation and evolution. We only present in this paper the first results from five snapshots, although we have now more than 200 snapshots from several of the codes that are participating and down to redshift of two, but this will be presented in a future project. We expect convergence on the stellar mass and dark matter distributions. And something very important and that needs to be clear here is that we expect big differences on the distribution and temperature and density of the gas. Why? Because we are using supernovae feedback recipes that are completely different from one code to the other. So we do not expect convergence on the gas properties in this comparison, something that is different from paper two. From these first results, for example, here in the gas properties, I will go first to one panel, later to the second panel. The first panel I will talk about is the one of temperature, that is this multi-panel plot at the right. The second panel is the density, the gas density, that is the panel at the, the panel at the left is the temperature, the panel at the right is the gas density. And for the gas temperature, you can see here this multi-panel, in where each column again is from one different code. You have the labels at the top for in referring to the code that has been used for each one of the simulations. And in each one of the rows, you can see the evolution on redshift, from redshift of 8 at the top to redshift of 4 at the bottom. And you can also see the circle, the dashed circle, is basically the virial radius of the halo we are analyzing. And you see here that the differences are big when referring to the temperature inside the virial radius, for example. And this is basically because of using very different supernovae feedback recipes. This is something expected, something that will need to be analyzed and that will have an impact on the final properties of the CGM that we have in this model. For the density, we have a better convergence. In fact, if you go to the paper, in the paper, we plot a histogram of the gas mass density in density bins. And you can see there that the convergence is quite good among codes, in particular in an intermediate range of densities. The divergences are more in the low density ranges and very high density ranges. That is something expected by the differences on the numerical codes that I will talk also a little bit later. After that, we analyzed another parameter, that is metallicity. Important to mention here that we check it that all codes are releasing the same amount of metals per supernovae when the supernovae explode. So the amount of metals per supernovae are the same, the metal yields are the same for all the codes. So the differences will be mostly related with the feedback strategies. You can see now at the right, again, the temperature density space colored by metals. You can see that as we expect, there are differences at the very low densities, very high temperatures. In this region, that is the very deep intergalactic medium, there is a difference on the sampling that can be provided by the AMR codes and the SPH codes. This is something well known and very expected. You can also observe differences in very high temperature, high density. These are due basically because some of the codes use the delayed cooling recipes while other codes know that doesn't use it. And finally, something that you can observe also is a feature in low temperature, high density. That is basically to not a problem, but something that will need to be corrected in the future inside the Graalkel tables we are using. You can find the details of this in the paper, but again, this doesn't imply, it's not very important for our final results in the crossbow run because it is at the very high density end in where the star formation already occurs. So it's not a problem for a cosmological simulation like the one we are presenting here. And at the left, you can see in a histogram of the total gas mass in metallicity beams. And again, you can see convergence in the intermediate metallicities and some divergence at low metallicities and at high metallicities. The divergence at high metallicities is mainly due to differences on the supernovae feedback. So how efficiently the feedback from the supernovae can spread metals to larger volumes. While in the very low metallicities, what happens is that we have differences, again, in a very low density regions, depending on if you use SPH or AMR, and also in the diffusion schemes. So some of the codes are better on diffusing metals than others. So we expect differences in the very low density, very low metallicity end. Finally, also another result is with the stellar properties. Here in this slide, you can see at the right, multi-panel plot again with the evolution of the stellar surface density. Again, for the stellar surface density, we have a very good convergence in most of the properties, the total stellar mass that is expected by the calibration for, and also in the location of the stellar structures. But we observe some differences on the measure history. So in some of the codes, due to probably differences on the time steps, we still need to check that, and this will be also another follow-up paper. We have differences on the moments of the major mergers we have in each one of the codes. But again, this will be well studied when using the full set of 200 snapshots, in where we will be able to build a merger tree for each one of the codes. This will be one of the follow-up papers. And at the left, again, a histogram of metallicity of a star binned by metallicity. So you have here basically convergence now in all the low metallicity, and this is basically convergence that we expect because the stars are formed in regions of high density. In this case, for the stars, we do not expect divergences in very low metallicities, basically because the stars at low metallicities are being formed at very high redshift when the supernovae have not had time to get metals from the supernovae feedback. Okay, and finally, although the original idea of the CosmoRun model was to analyze the CGM, as I told you, the CGM will be analyzed in the follow-up paper. We make only a very first look in this paper. You can go to the paper and take a look on that. And we observe basically differences on metallicity. That is basically this multi-panel plot at the top right. And also we look at the kinematics. For example, here you can see for each one of the codes, the kinematics of the gas, the radial velocity of the gas. In the first panel at the left is the total gas mass. The second panel, from the left to the right, first panel, all the gas, second panel, cold gas, that is gas below 3 × 10⁴, third panel, cool gas, fourth panel is the warm gas, and finally the hot gas, that is the one released by the supernovae, is the one at the right, the rightermost panel, is the hot gas from the supernovae, in where you can see, for example, differences between the blue line, that is the arc code, that is more efficient on driving outflows than, for example, some of the other codes. This will be fully analyzed in the future follow-up paper of the CGM. These are the results we can present and we present in this paper, in this third paper on the collaboration. And we now have many ideas for follow-up papers. Some of the codes are really reached redshift of 2. A secondary goal is to reach redshift of 0, probably some years from now, because the codes get slower when you reach lower redshift. Also, we already initiated several follow-up papers. I will talk about them very fast in the next slide. And the details on the next comparisons within the project will be discussed in the next Agora workshop. And again, the new code groups are still in time on catching us up with this new future projects. So now, finishing with the presentation, the follow-up papers. The first one is the study of the CGM. We already have the tools. We will use a YT script and also a tool developed by Clayton Strawn, that is a PhD student in the UCSC, that is called Quasar Scan. that allows you to compute the sidelines of background quasars, so we will be able to compare each one of the models, both between them and also with observations. It is important to mention here that the resolution that we have in this model, in the CGM, probably will only allow us to study high ionization ions. So this is something important that we will need to discuss in the next Agora workshop. Also, important, you have here many plots we have on mind to do to analyze the CGM, and this is extracted from the Agora workspace that for the moment is just allowed only the people within the collaboration had access to the Agora workspace. But as I told you, you are free to join us if you are enthusiastic on making this kind of comparisons, and probably you can give us a lot of ideas and help us with the discussion of the science. You can just join, you can ask the project coordinator, and you can enter the collaboration just asking it. The second follow-up paper is what we call the re-edition of the Santa Barbara Cluster Project. It's a technical paper, very basic, in where we want to understand why there are differences when you use only a pure collapse model, why you have differences on, for example, shock heating, or maybe numerical heating, or we don't know where the source of heating we have comes from. So this is something we are studying in this new paper. We call it technical paper, but the idea is to have something similar to the Santa Barbara Cluster Project that was done back in the 90s, and that many of the current codes used in the community never went through to a comparison like the one that the people did in the Santa Barbara Cluster Project. So we need to do this sanity check, and we propose all the code groups around the world to come to participate and to do this new sanity check for their codes. And finally, we have many other ideas for follow-up papers. And again, we want people from other code groups, from maybe also using the same code, but different versions to the ones that we are using now in the Agora collaboration, to participate. And we, for example, give them the opportunity to make a short presentation, to record a video, a clip, with a well-defined science case, telling us the diagnostics that this science case will require, and also information on who will lead these papers. And this is very important because each paper needs a leader that drives the comparison. So everybody that really have this well-defined science case can participate. You can just send an email to the santacruzgalaxy@gmail.com, that is basically the email of the project coordinator, and present it in the next Agora workshop. And the future of the Agora project, I put it here, a picture of the entrance of the University of California in Santa Cruz. We all the people in the Agora project, we miss a lot the UCSC. So we hope next year, 2022, we can again have a meeting, a physical meeting there. This year again, we will have an Agora workshop, probably in August 12, 13. This information will be published in the Agora webpage. But this year again will be virtual. Hopefully next year it will be again physical. Also to announce that the paper 3 will release all the data of this paper 3 in the coming month. First, only the data from calibration steps and these 5 redshifts, 8, 7, 6, 5, and 4. And the future, we also will release the full set of thin time steps. And we are working on having a friendly interface and inside a real level host where to download the data. And finally, just to announce that Ji-Hoon Kim, the project coordinator, fully renewed the webpage, a lot of work. And now you can go to the public webpage of the Agora project and see the details of the project. And also, if you are inside the project, you will get access to the project workspace in where you have all the details on the comparisons, the details on the initial conditions, etc., etc. So please feel free to ask to enter the collaboration and to give us your science to the project. And finally, the summary. We presented this calibration strategy that is designed to reduce the tunable parameters in the simulations, so to make easier the comparison of the final results of the models we are generating. I put here, we built a suite of models. Yes, we built a suite of models, but I think we started building a large suite of models. Hopefully many more codes will join us and we'll make the same calibration process to get new models and join the future comparisons. And this will allow us to compare and validate new codes and new subgrid physics that will be probably implemented in the future as when we know better the physics of the galaxy formation. We are starting many follow-up projects, and everybody is invited to join us and to propose new projects and to enrich these comparisons we are making. And I think that's all. I end just with two very nice movies of this Cosmoran model, only down to Redshift of 4. This was produced by Yves Rebat, one of the co-leaders in the collaboration. And you can see at the bottom left, the evolution of the gas evolution, and at the top right, the evolution of the dark matter structures for two codes, one AMR, one SPH, one is Ramses, the other one is GEAR. And something you can see, for example, is that the measure time is different in each one of them. That is something we will study in the future. And also that ongoing major merger that happens around Redshift of 4, that is where we ended our comparison for this project. So the results of this major merger will be presented in the future in the new follow-up projects. So that's all. Thank you for listening. I'm sorry for, it was 40 minutes instead of 30, but I hope you, it was a nice presentation for you and you could understand more or less what we are doing and what we are going to do in the future. So thank you, and now I will take questions by the audience.
Thank you, Santi. Any questions, please raise your hand in the Zoom. Okay, Jorge, please.
Thank you, Octavio. Thank you, Santi, for this very nice presentation. I was wondering, since you have this very nice suite of simulations, do you have any idea or have you tried to compare this with actual observations of galaxies? In particular, we have been tackling this, for example, you mentioned in one of the slides, the metallicity gradient, the ionized gas metallicity gradient in galaxies in the nearby universe. So I was wondering if you have you tried or thought to explore this comparison between observations and your simulations?
This is a very good question, and probably you could see inside the follow-up project, the possible follow-up projects we are thinking on, that one of them is just to study the metallicity gradients inside galaxies. The point here is that we need to run these models to lower redshift to be able to start doing that, because at redshift of 4 and having this major merging ongoing at redshift of 4, we don't expect to have a very nice disk. But probably, in fact, we have some models that already reached redshift of 0.2, for example, as low as 0.2, and we see that a very well, very nice disk is being developed. And we hope in this lower redshift scenario, we will be able to make this kind of comparisons of the metallicity gradients. It's not now, but in the future, we will surely do that. Something that is important is that it is not straightforward to compare each one of the codes with observations. The first goal now is try to find which are the differences among codes. And we are not planning to tell this code is better to this other one for the moment. So till now, the Agora goals are only just the comparison among them and to see which results are converging or not within codes. And the next step will be this comparison with observations, of course, is the final goal of that, yes. Not only for the metallicity gradients, also we are thinking on at low redshift to study the stability of disks, for example, the formation of bars, the properties of bars that can be formed at low redshift. And also, for example, as I told you, the sidelines to quasars in the background to observe how the CGN differs from one code to the other. But we need this redshift of 2 or below to make this kind of comparisons.
Okay.
Thank you.
Luis Aguilar has a question and then Vladimir.
Okay, it's really not a question. It's more like a historical comment. Thanks for the talk, Santi. It was very nice, and I'm glad to hear that people are starting to take seriously this business of comparison. Well, the comment I want to make is that, I don't know if you are aware about this, but this happened long ago. In the 60s, people were starting to discover what is called now the gravothermal catastrophe in globular clusters, where the inner part starts contracting and the envelope expands. And at the beginning, people were not sure about this behavior. They were attributing this to perhaps the details depending on the particulars of the embodied simulation that we're using. So Myron Lecar at the CFA, Center for Astrophysics, organized a joint experiment in which he provided with exactly the same initial conditions and everybody tried with the different n-body codes, and then they have a conference in which they compare all of these results. So this reminds me of this. So I congratulate you and your team in doing this. I think this is very important. If we're going to study something as complicated as the large scale structure of the universe and how everything develops, we better have trust in the tools, the numerical tools that we're using. And you guys are providing that. Congratulations again.
Thank you a lot. Just to add that basically I kind of lead this collaborative effort that is the paper three, but the main contributor to the Agora is Jihong Kim, that is the coordinator. And also we have a steering committee. But yes, this scenario of the 60s reminds me a lot the Agora project. And clearly something that we need to do. We need to make these comparisons. We cannot present results for a single code and say, these are observations. We really need to know which things are or not dependent on the code.
Well, if things don't coincide with observations, then damn the observations.
Yeah, that's true. Maybe the observations are wrong. Yes.
Okay. Vladimir?
Okay. Thank you, Santi, for your nice presentation, and congratulations to all the collaboration for this great effort. As for the numerical techniques, did you find some systematical differences in your results in between the MAMR and SPH codes? Something that can tell you that the techniques is affecting your results?
Mm-hmm. There are many results that are well known in the community that differs from SPH codes and AMR. And of course, we are also suffering of that. For example, the very, very low density regions in the IGM is not the same sampling it with the particles than sampling it with a mesh. So in the mesh, you always can have gas in all the places in the IGM. While, for example, if you have a very, very low density mass of the gas in the IGM and your mass resolution is 10 to the 5 solar masses, you'll have one particle in a very big region in the intergalactic medium. So the sampling that can provide an AMR code is different from the one that can provide an SPH. Also, another difference, for example, is that you need to introduce some kind of diffusion also in these very low density regions to allow the transmission of metals, for example, between particles in the SPH. This is something that is naturally produced in AMR. But on the other way, you have, for example, that in SPH you are able to produce more substructure at higher redshift than the one you can produce in the AMR code. Also, we found that there is kind of a dependence on the strategy for the refinement on how well you trace, for example, the shocks at very high redshift. But these are the things that you learn when you are doing these comparisons. And knowing that, you can then make fair comparisons with observations. Yeah, you are right that we need to know these things to be able to be sure of that what we are comparing is something we can compare, in fact, because it's something not numerical. No? But yeah, we found several of these systematics that most of them are already known, and most of them and some of them can be probably discussed in future meetings in the collaboration. Also to mention that these differences, you can never say that one code is better than the other, and these moments in where you find these differences, it's not easy to know if the difference is due to problems on the numerics, something physical, is something expected. So the discussions when you find the difference are extremely nice inside the collaboration, and you learn a lot from the other people from the other code groups. So these points, the differences, are always the most important part of this collaboration. Yeah. I don't know if I answered your question.
Yes. Yeah. This is the problem. There is a degeneracy between the numerical techniques and the gastrophysical conditions, feedback, star formation. So it's not easy.
Not at all. And the point is that in the previous comparisons, usually, or in some of the most recent comparisons, there is not this process of calibrating the models. And the calibration, you know, I told you that it was 5 years of collaboration to produce this paper, and most of these 5 years was to produce the calibration. So to generate a model and to compare a model with others is not as difficult as that. The problem is that if you want to calibrate them to reduce the parameter space, this is the tricky part. Yeah, right. Sure.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you to you. Thanks for having
me. More questions or comments from the audience? In the meantime, I would like to ask you, Santi, is there any plan to do a similar exercise to more massive galaxies and include maybe AGM feedback? Or surely you have thought about it.
I was here only presenting the results of this project that we called CosmoRun and the possible follow-up papers. But inside the Agora collaboration, if you go to the Agora collaboration webpage, the public one, you will see that there are several science cases that are there from the very beginning. And these include more massive halos. These include another kind of isolated models. There are several different projects that can be done inside the collaboration. The big problem always is that you need a leader that leads this effort and that wants to put time on doing that. But yes, the idea of making different, of producing simulations of different halos with different masses, lower masses, higher masses, all this is inside the ideas of the collaboration, yes. Including the AGN feedback is not as easy as that. Some of the code doesn't have any version with AGN included, so it's not as easy as that. It's something that, of course, probably in the future will need to be done, and this is the direction. No, all the codes need to implement AGN at some point because we know that it has a strong impact in the inner regions, but for now, it will be quite difficult to get a comparison among codes that include the AGNs and, for example, black holes formation.
Okay, thank you. Any other question or comment? Okay, if there is no another question, we thank Santi for the interesting presentation and we will proceed to some questions from the media. Thank you.
Thank you, Octavio. And thank you everybody for coming.
Gracias.
Muchas gracias. Iniciaremos con la sesión de preguntas. Les agradecemos a los participantes. Les recordamos a los medios de comunicación que pueden enviarnos su pregunta vía WhatsApp con su nombre, medio y a quién le dirigen su pregunta.
Antes de las preguntas, me gustaría hago un breve resumen también en español sobre la presentación que acabo de dar.
Adelante.
Perfecto, pues vuelvo a compartir pantalla. Pues básicamente voy a presentar un poco los últimos resultados del proyecto Agora brevemente. Para empezar, simplemente mencionar, explicar un poco qué es el proyecto Agora. El proyecto Agora es una colaboración de varios grupos de investigación que usan las simulaciones para entender cómo se forman y evolucionan las galaxias. En el presente es un equipo de más de 160 personas de más de 60 instituciones alrededor del mundo. En esta primera diapositiva, lo que pueden ver aquí es un poco un resumen del espíritu de lo que es la colaboración Agora y de los proyectos que ya se han realizado y de la infraestructura que se ha desarrollado en torno al proyecto. Los objetivos principales son esto: desarrollar esta infraestructura para poder comparar distintos códigos, generar unas condiciones iniciales, a partir de las cuales se pueden iniciar del mismo modo todos los modelos para generar el mismo tipo de sistemas galácticos en este caso, y también focalizarse en una comparación global de lo que es esta simulación y no solo en los detalles. De acuerdo, no que sea una sola comparación en un momento dado de la evolución de una galaxia, sino una comparación con toda la evolución de la galaxia. Y algo muy importante que es mantener que haya mucha discusión entre los miembros de la comunidad. En el proyecto se han publicado ya tres artículos, aquí estoy presentando el tercero, pero tenemos uno primero en el cual se presentaron los objetivos del artículo y se hizo una simulación en la cual solo había materia oscura que colapsaba, de acuerdo, sin gas, en las galaxias, básicamente la materia oscura establece el esqueleto de los sistemas galácticos, mientras que el gas es como el recubrimiento, ¿no? lo que le da la formación a las galaxias, ¿de acuerdo? Las galaxias se forman en torno a estas estructuras de materia oscura. Y en ese primer artículo se usaron 9 códigos distintos y se consiguió tener un buen resultado, una buena convergencia entre los distintos códigos en lo que son los perfiles de qué tan densos y de cómo era de denso el halo desde sus zonas interiores a las zonas más externas. En el segundo artículo dejamos ya las simulaciones cosmológicas y nos centramos en la simulación de la formación y evolución, perdón, más en la evolución de un disco galáctico aislado del tipo de la Vía Láctea, y aquí se usaron otra vez 9 códigos distintos a los primeros, y aquí se simuló cómo evolucionaba un disco tipo de la Vía Láctea cuando usábamos distintos códigos numéricos, pero con lo que serían, lo que le llamamos nosotros la física interna, pues muy parecida entre los distintos códigos, que difería un poco de la que se usa normalmente en las comunidades de cada uno de los códigos. Durante el proceso de generar estos 2 artículos, que llevó estos 2 más 2 años, se ha conseguido desarrollar una infraestructura que nos permite hacer nuevas comparaciones, como la que estamos presentando hoy aquí, y esta infraestructura incluye desde software para generar condiciones iniciales idénticas para todos, un software para analizar los resultados de las simulaciones del mismo modo, usando la misma herramienta. Hasta el momento se usaban herramientas distintas para cada código, ahora usamos la misma herramienta para todos los códigos, lo que nos permite quitar un grado de libertad a la comparación. Y finalmente un código que nos permite ver del mismo modo, usar y calcular del mismo modo en todas las simulaciones cómo el gas se enfría o se calienta dentro de las galaxias. El resultado del proyecto que estamos presentando hoy aquí, que es lo más novedoso de este proyecto, es que básicamente por primera vez se ha hecho la simulación de la formación de una galaxia tipo Vía Láctea hasta un tiempo, no hasta el presente, pero hasta un tiempo cercano, digamos, usando 7 códigos distintos. Estos 7 códigos son algunos de los códigos que más se usan actualmente en la comunidad para estudiar la formación de galaxias. Esto es el proyecto 3 de Agora. Y en este proyecto básicamente nos llevó 4 años de colaboración intensa, más de 30 conferencias online distribuidas mes a mes, digamos cada mes una teleconferencia, 3 congresos internacionales en 3 veranos, y tuvimos que usar más de 100 millones de horas de computadora, de CPU, para generar todos estos modelos y los procesos de calibración. Y se usaron al final para esta comparación 7 códigos, que como he dicho es la primera vez que se hace en la comunidad internacional. Para llevar a cabo esto se desarrolló un proceso de calibración que nos permite, los códigos numéricos tienen muchas veces varios parametritos que se tienen que modificar o se pueden modificar para que den obtener algunos resultados que se parecen más o menos a las observaciones. Lo que queríamos nosotros es reducir al máximo estos parámetros que se pueden tocar para hacer que las simulaciones cambien un poco, y lo que hicimos es generar este proceso de calibración de 4 pasos, en el primero de los cuales comparamos qué ocurre cuando tenemos un colapso sin que el gas pueda calentarse o enfriarse por radiación, que se dice. Tampoco hay un fondo de calentamiento como el que existe en el universo. Simplemente colapso, caída de gas y materia oscura y ver qué ocurre. Y con esto pudimos ver si convergían, si llegamos a los mismos resultados usando los 7 códigos distintos o no. Y si no llegábamos a los mismos resultados, pues ver el por qué esto no ocurría, y luego esto nos podría llevar a otro estudio. Encontramos convergencia, luego pudimos seguir a la calibración 2, en la cual lo único que hacemos es ver si cuando introducimos el enfriamiento y calentamiento del gas y esta fuente de calentamiento externa usando el mismo software que le llamamos Grackle, pues si esta implementación se ha hecho correctamente en todos los códigos. Simplemente la calibración 2 se hace para esto, para ver si la implementación es la correcta. También vimos que era correcta en todos los códigos, en los que no lo era, pues se tuvieron que correr nuevos modelos hasta que se implementó correctamente. Esto es el por qué nos llevó tanto tiempo hacer estos pasos de calibración. En el paso 3 de calibración, además del calentamiento y enfriamiento del gas intergaláctico, añadimos la formación de estrellas. Hasta el momento no habíamos añadido formación de estrellas. Aquí ya se forman estrellas, y lo que requerimos aquí es que todos los códigos formen más o menos el mismo número de estrellas a un tiempo muy lejano al presente, a lo que le llamamos alto redshift. Luego, una vez conseguido esto, podemos proceder al siguiente paso de tiempo, aunque observamos algunas diferencias con solo activar la formación estelar y con solo el colapso del gas entre los códigos, que es algo que se va a estudiar en un proyecto que está ya en proceso. y que se está también desarrollando en computadoras como, por ejemplo, la computadora MISTI aquí en la UNAM o a Tocatl en el Instituto de Astronomía. Son dos de las grandes computadoras que se están usando para este proyecto. Para el paso cuarto de calibración, lo que se hace es que cada grupo se le permite usar su receta para las explosiones, para la liberación de energía a través de las explosiones de las estrellas. Una vez han nacido, han evolucionado y mueren, pues cuando mueren al explotar se produce la supernova que libera mucha energía. Pues la forma de liberar esta energía es distinta en los 7 códigos que tenemos en la colaboración, y hemos permitido que cada grupo mantenga su propia receta de retroalimentación de supernova. Esto es diferente de lo que se hizo en el artículo 2, en el paper 2 que les he mencionado antes, el del disco aislado, de la galaxia aislada. Allá se imponía una misma receta para la retroalimentación, aquí no. Aquí cada grupo usa la que normalmente usa para su ciencia del día a día. Y lo único que se les pide es que la cantidad de estrellas que se han formado sea la que predicen los modelos científicos, que son estos 10 a la 9 más asoladas a Redshift 4. Y hecho esto, hecha la calibración, nosotros presentamos uno de los grandes resultados aquí, es este proceso, el propio proceso de calibración, que es lo que nos llevó más tiempo, y que ahora todos los grupos que no han participado hasta el momento pueden usarlo para generar nuevos modelos y enriquecer aún más esta comparación que estamos haciendo dentro de Agora. En la segunda parte importante de resultados que tenemos es el propio modelo, el que por primera vez se ha hecho de una formación de una galaxia tipo la Vía Láctea hasta Redshift 4. En este artículo solo mostramos los resultados en 5 instantes distintos, aunque ahora ya tenemos análisis para más de 200 instantes distintos. Esperamos que haya una buena convergencia entre los distintos modelos, que se parezcan mucho las distribuciones de estrellas y de materia oscura en los 7 distintos códigos, mientras que esperamos grandes diferencias en el gas, porque estamos diciendo que cada modelo usa su propia receta para emitir energía de las regiones donde se forman estrellas. Luego es de esperar que el gas se caliente de forma distinta alrededor de estas regiones de formación estelar. De los resultados, pues tenemos la temperatura, este plot de muchos paneles, tienen en cada columna un código distinto de los 7 códigos que se han usado, que se llaman ART, ENSO, RAMSES, CHANGA, GADGET, GEAR y GIZMO, y en cada fila es a un tiempo, a un instante de tiempo distinto, desde más antiguo arriba a más moderno, más cercano al presente, el de abajo del todo. Y lo que se ve aquí coloreado es la temperatura. Cuanto más amarillo, más caliente, cuanto más azul, más frío. Y ven que realmente hay diferencias dependiendo de cómo las estrellas se están formando en el mero centro, dentro de este círculo de línea punteada, pues en el centro se están formando estrellas y desde allá se emite la energía y por eso se ve cómo se calienta el gas a partir de allá. Y pueden ver que es muy distinta la forma de calentar el gas en cada uno de los códigos. Esto que les muestro aquí es el mismo como el panel que les he mostrado anteriormente, pero ahora para la densidad de gas. Se ven aquí como unos filamentos por donde cae el gas hasta el sistema galáctico central, que es esta esferita, ¿no?, que se ve en el centro, en medio de esta línea roja punteada, que es en donde se está formando la galaxia. Y ven que en el gas, a diferencia de la temperatura, parece que los resultados son mucho más parecidos de un código al otro. Finalmente, también en la metalicidad, la cantidad de los metales, saben que se producen en las supernovas, en la explosión de las estrellas es donde se producen todos los elementos más pesados que el hidrógeno y el helio, básicamente. Luego aquí también analizamos un poco cómo se distribuyen estos metales después de estallar las supernovas. Y obviamente también esperamos diferencias según el código, básicamente por las diferencias en la liberación de esta energía de metales. Para las estrellas, en el multipanel que tienen aquí a la derecha, ven la distribución de estrellas, la galaxia propiamente que se está formando, otra vez arriba del todo lo más antiguo, abajo del todo que la ven mucho más grande, lo más moderno, más cercano a la actualidad, y otra vez ven que más o menos aquí sí que para estrellas se llega a una convergencia bastante buena, más o menos se ven las mismas estructuras en cada columna, que cada columna es un código distinto, ¿vale? Y se ven algunas diferencias en metales, que es el panel de la izquierda. Para más detalles pueden ir a visitar el artículo que hemos publicado. Aquí un poco más sobre los metales y también sobre cómo es capaz cada código de inducir gases que se escapan a cierta velocidad de la región de formación de estrellas. Y para acabar, simplemente decir que se están realizando muchos proyectos nuevos que van a seguir. Este proyecto principal que hemos presentado ahora va a permitir que se hagan muchos proyectos nuevos a partir de los datos que estamos proporcionando. hacer otra vez hincapié que muchos de estos datos para los códigos que les presento aquí, el Ramsés, que es en la tercera columna, para el Changa y para el ART, que es la primera columna, estos tres se han producido básicamente en computadoras mexicanas. En Mistli básicamente se ha producido Changa y Ramsés, y en Atocatl, en el IAUNAM, se ha producido el ART 1, con muchísimas horas, muchísimos millones de horas de computación en estas computadoras de la UNAM. Y nada, para terminar, algunos de los proyectos que se han empezado a hacer ya, a estudiar el gas circumgaláctico, a estudiar los detalles de cómo están implementados los códigos y muchos más, y aquí se anima a gente de la comunidad pues a entrar en la colaboración, proponer nuevos casos y que nosotros podamos continuar todos juntos con estos nuevos casos científicos. También decir que va a haber un congreso de Agora en agosto, el 12-13 de agosto se va a hacer virtual y va a haber más información en la página web del grupo. También que se van a liberar los datos en los próximos meses para que la gente de la comunidad la pueda usar para nuevos proyectos. Y también que se va a renovar, se ha renovado la página web y tienen aquí los links a la página web pública y a la página web para los miembros del proyecto. Decir también que se está proponiendo que parte de los datos o todos los datos que se van a publicar y hacer públicos a la comunidad estén situados en algunos de los centros de supercomputo de México, o por lo menos un espejo en donde poder descargarlos. Y eso es todo un poco el resumen de esto que hemos presentado, una estrategia de calibración que puede ser usada ahora por la comunidad internacional. Estamos construyendo un set de nuevos modelos de formación de una galaxia tipo Vía Láctea que se va a enriquecer en un futuro, que una buena parte de ellos se han producido en computadoras de la UNAM y que la colaboración de Agora sigue en pie con muchos nuevos proyectos invitando a nueva gente a participar. Y básicamente terminábamos con estos dos videos. Abajo a la izquierda un video de la evolución del gas, arriba a la derecha una evolución de la materia oscura para dos códigos distintos, tienen dos paneles, a la izquierda panel Ramsés, a la derecha panel Gear. El Ramsés, recuerden que son datos obtenidos en la computadora Mistli del DGTIC de la UNAM. Y esto es un poco el resumen de lo que es el proyecto 3 de Agora que estamos presentando hoy aquí. Y ahora pues aceptaremos preguntas de los medios.
Muchas gracias, doctor. Tenemos varias preguntas de Joaquín Tinoco, reportero de AMX Noticias. Una pregunta que nos hace es, ¿qué significado tienen estos resultados en el conocimiento de la formación de las galaxias y qué papel jugó la supercomputadora Mistli?
Perfecto, pues la supercomputadora Mistli, como he comentado, básicamente se obtuvieron los resultados para uno de los códigos que es Changa. Y este lo corrió, tenemos aquí también al doctor Víctor Velázquez, que es el que se encargó de producir esta simulación en Mistli. Y luego se produjo Ramsés también en Mistli y también con la ayuda del doctor Víctor Velázquez, que es del Instituto de Astronomía de la UNAM. Y luego se usó Atocatl también del IA para producir los resultados de ART1. ¿Y el significado de los resultados? Bueno, hasta el momento no podemos hacer una comparación directa con las observaciones, pero estos resultados nos permiten que en un futuro podamos realmente decir qué cosas de las que observamos se pueden comparar directamente con las observaciones, es decir, nos permiten ganar conocimiento de cómo se forman las galaxias reales y cuáles son solo resultado de los códigos numéricos de la computación, cómo se ha hecho en los ordenadores. Luego, lo importante de aquí es esto, que nos va a permitir distinguir entre lo que es real, lo que es numérico y así ganar conocimiento sobre lo que se está produciendo en la formación y evolución de galaxias. Héctor, no sé si quieres añadir algo más también sobre el proceso de Changa y de Ramsés en Mistli.
Bueno, simplemente que son códigos que requieren bastante un uso intensivo de cómputo. Entonces aquí Mistli ha sido una herramienta fundamental para poder llevar a cabo este tipo de simulaciones. Y bueno, no solamente es Mistli, sino toda el apoyo que nos ha brindado la coordinación de supercómputo de la DGTIC. Aquí está el representante Leobardo Itegua. Y siempre han estado dispuestos a apoyarnos, darnos un gran apoyo. También la gente que está atrás de la MOD, que también ha sido bastante útil y bastante, nos ha apoyado bastante para poder sacar adelante este proyecto, básicamente.
Muchas gracias. Y tenemos otras dos preguntas. ¿Qué importancia tiene la coordinación internacional para obtener estos resultados y cómo motivarían a otros científicos a colaborar con ustedes? Además, ¿de cuánto tiempo tardaron en crear esta simulación?
Creo que es la parte más dura. La coordinación internacional siempre es la parte más dura, no solo por las grandes diferencias horarias en las cuales tienes gente que se está reuniendo contigo a las 3 de la mañana y gente que se está reuniendo a las 3 del mediodía y a las 7 de la noche. Luego es complicado no solo coordinar gente, porque todo el mundo, sobre todo los científicos, tenemos normalmente opiniones muy fuertes. Luego siempre es complicado a lidiar con este tipo de cosas. Pero bueno, al final la colaboración es muy enriquecedora y está muy bien, sobre todo porque ves formas muy distintas de participar de los distintos países que participan. Fíjense que prácticamente no hay más de un representante de cada uno de los países participantes. Luego, realmente, al final es súper internacional la colaboración. Y sobre lo que se tardó, ya lo ven, más de 4 años de reuniones, de correr modelos y modelos y modelos y horas de CPU en ordenadores como MISLI, o como otras alrededor del mundo. Y la forma de motivar a gente a participar, bueno, a mí se me motivó cuando era un joven doctor prácticamente salido del horno tanto del IA UNAM como de Barcelona. Pues es esto, animar que hayan hecho algo en su tesis. Y a esto animo mucho, por ejemplo, a estudiantes mexicanos a que participen, por ejemplo. Simplemente contactando conmigo, contactando con el coordinador de Agora, es relativamente fácil de permitirles entrar. Porque fíjense que esta colaboración no es algo a lo que el doctor Héctor Velázquez o yo esté dedicando el 100% de mi tiempo. De algún modo, esto es un proyecto al lado de todos los proyectos que realmente nos dan trabajo en nuestros puestos de trabajo. O sea, Agora es como lo que hacemos es como nuestro hobby prácticamente, ¿no? Con los tiempos libres en los que nos podemos dedicar, pues lo dedicamos a Agora. Luego, siempre es conveniente tener nueva gente con ganas de participar y normalmente los jóvenes investigadores son los más entusiastas. Por eso realmente animaría un montón a los estudiantes recientes, por ejemplo, en la UNAM o en las otras universidades mexicanas que hayan trabajado en simulaciones y tengan ganas de entrarle a Agora, pues que lo pregunten y estaríamos encantados de incluirlos.
Muchas gracias. Una pregunta para el doctor Velázquez. ¿Cuándo comenzó su trabajo en Agora y qué es lo más relevante que le ha llamado la atención de los resultados obtenidos hasta ahorita?
Bueno, mi trabajo en Agora comenzó aproximadamente hace tal vez 2 años. Digamos, fue una participación un poco, inicialmente fue compleja, pero eventualmente me fui acoplando al grupo, fue incorporándome a qué código era el que me llamaba la atención, y en particular el código que me llamó la atención fue Changa. Los resultados más relevantes es precisamente que Agora nos proporciona una plataforma que nos permite comparar los diferentes códigos, ver cuáles son las similitudes, las diferencias, y eventualmente tratar de identificar a qué se deben estas diferencias. Pues básicamente es lo más relevante.
Muchas gracias. Y otra pregunta para el doctor Octavio Valenzuela. ¿Podría decirnos cuál es la importancia de que supercomputadoras como MISLI sean consideradas para ayudar en proyectos como este?
Ok. Bueno, en realidad algo que quisiera también agregar es que este proyecto solo se pudo haber realizado de manera internacional, ¿no? Como acaban de mencionar, estos cientos de millones de horas de CPU, por ejemplo, rebasa lo que está disponible en un año en varias de estas supercomputadoras, ¿no? Ahora, es muy importante porque empuja los límites tanto de la tecnología como de nuestro conocimiento para manejar y explotar esa tecnología, como de las herramientas, ¿no? El personal técnico. Y imagínense, ¿no? Si uno puede capturar cómo se forma nuestra galaxia o un pedazo del universo, uno puede aplicar, igual de demandante son los problemas que describen la atmósfera, el clima, por ejemplo, lo que estamos todavía viviendo y acabamos de vivir tan difícil para todo el mundo, ¿no? La pandemia del COVID. también hacen uso de computadoras muy grandes. Entonces, tener desde estudiantes, gente joven, personal técnico, que puedan explotar esa tecnología, esto es una especie de laboratorio, ¿no?, para empujar estas fronteras, ¿no?
Muchas gracias. Pues creo que con estas preguntas damos por concluida la conferencia de prensa. Les agradecemos a los participantes, a las autoridades del Instituto de Astronomía y de la DGTIC su apoyo para la realización de esta conferencia de prensa. Asimismo, agradecemos a los medios de comunicación y a sus representantes la participación. Que tengan muy buena tarde.
Muchas gracias.